on their transmitter network. Those transmissions are getting optimized, and as we saw on the slide, there are even additional transmitters now being brought up with DRM and installed. We have extended hours in the existing transmitters of digital-only transmissions, which give more content. And there is the innovation in content. At least that's starting, very good. We have the news channel, we have the cricket information. We just learned that also the journal line will be enhanced to provide these scorecards for cricket and more information. So there's a lot of work going on, and particularly if we manage to also bring additional players into the field, like private broadcasters in terms of content enrichment. So we have the transmission side, we have the content side in place, and as we see this year, with millions of cars on the road, that is a very unusual situation. No other country ever rolling out digital radio was in such a great position at the time of public launch. And we see all these new additional models of receivers coming up at very affordable price points. If you compare with what we discussed 2 years ago in terms of pricing, this is a fraction already. Full-featured receivers, and you can see them at the booth. Which means that at this point in time, the full ecosystem is in place. All of these elements need further improvement, but everything today now finally is in place. We have the transmission, we have the content being further improved, and we have the receiver side in place. Now the final step is, as we heard earlier, to bring it all together. Sunset is one option for the future that will definitely speed up the process, but today what we are discussing, and what we also discussed extensively at the stakeholders meeting, is the public launch date. It means that with all the work being done, with all the preparatory elements in place, all the pillars in place, now is the time to take the whole project public to the listeners and make them aware. This will create the demand for the receivers that we heard is an absolute requirement. It is an important information for the car industry to carry on bringing out even more receivers. And it also streamlines the internal work of All India Radio being focused on a specific launch date. In addition, one thing we cannot forget is the element of distribution, making the receivers available with publicity events in the big flagship stores so that people can go there, can experience digital radio, and buy the receiver right away. At the stakeholders meeting, we heard that there are multiple options for this public launch date. That could be the Cricket World Cup, it could be the Diwali. Diwali this year has the additional benefit if we start the official launch publication of All India Radio to the consumers, let's say a month ahead of Diwali, I mean the official launch date. Then the receivers would make a wonderful present for Diwali itself. Just a thought. In any case, this launch date, when to take the whole package public and make the people aware, putting up the big billboards, making all the announcements on air, explaining what DRM is and what the benefits are for the listeners, exciting them about these new possibilities. This is now very quickly required, that announcement of the date, so that the whole stakeholders group, All India Radio, the internal content department, any external partners feeding into the services, and also receiver industry and retail industry, can agree on this date and work towards that date. This is the next step that is now the logical succession of elements, and this will then establish the time when the public and the listeners in the country for the first time really get fully exposed to digital radio and hear about it.
Alex, thank you very much, and you have already the slide here summarizing exactly what you just said. Thank you. Any other comments from the floor, because we have to wrap up, and I think we had a very good session. Some a little bit emotional at some stage, but it's important to have that as well. And very good comments and answers to our esteemed panelists, who have done a very, very good job. One comment.
Regarding DRM, I would say that people have talked about sunset date. I think within the government, there is a discussion about sunset date. I think 2021 TRAI has proposed, but after that, no deliberations or no clear-cut terms have come. So yes, it is being discussed, But you know, the things are not clear, so it is not clear. Maybe some enablers are needed, such as our esteemed receiver developers or transmitters are coming and they are reditating. So these enablers will help the government to decide a cutoff date for analog. So thank you.
No, but I would like to add that Honorable MIB Minister has already given a date that by 2024 that the broadcasting in India will be totally digital. So in any case, we have to keep that date in mind.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pal. So one is the sunset and one is the launch date, which Alexander Zink referred to, basically announcing publicly, yes, the DRM is being rolled out also to the listeners so that they know exactly what's going on, the retailers, the distributors, the manufacturers, all are then involved in that after that particular date, which is very important to be announced. So thank you very much to everybody. The conclusion is that we have to cooperate, to have courage, as my esteemed chairman from the DRM Consortium once said in the stakeholders meeting, you have to have the courage to go ahead and do your job because you do it very, very well. Not a lot of countries have done it so well as India, such a big country, in a very short period of time in certain instances. So congratulations to Prasar Bharati and All India Radio for the good job done so far, and also to our receiver manufacturers who have produced receivers, which you can see in our booth, 49 and 61. If you want to know more about the DRM, please download our handbook from our website, which is www.drm.org. And if you have other questions, please call our office, write to our office, the project office, and we are going to answer your questions. Thank you very much. Thank you to all.
Thank you very much, Mr. Obreja, for chairing the session. May I request the audience members to kindly be seated because we have got the prestigious awards which will be presented to the local chapters, the representatives of the local chapters. So I will request all the audience members to be seated. The tea would be served after the culmination of this session and after the recipients receive their awards. But before we actually proceed on, a very insightful, very interactive, very thought-provoking exchange here in this session, as promised by Mr. Obreja that it will be a very interesting, interactive session, true to his words. I would like to thank all the speakers and the panelists. Thank you very much for your invaluable inputs and your thoughts. As a token of our appreciation on behalf of BES, I would request the session chairperson, Mr. Obreja, to kindly present the mementos to our speakers. If I may request the session chairperson to present a token of our appreciation to Rajesh Kurian from NXP. Please, ladies and gentlemen, a very warm applause for Mr. Rajesh Kurian for his time and his invaluable inputs. May I? Can I also now request the session chairperson to please present the next memento to Sri Nilesh from Gospel Digital Limited. Thank you very much, Mr. Nilesh, for your time today. Please, a very warm applause for him. Thank you. May I now request the session chairperson to present the memento of appreciation to Yogendra Pal, Honorary DRM Chair India. Thank you very much, sir. It was interesting to listen to you. We indeed take a lot from this presentation, from this session. May I request Sri Rajat Nair to kindly accept this small memento on behalf of BES 2020. Mr. Johannes, please, from Star Waves Germany, thank you very much for your time and for your key inputs. May I now request the session chairperson to please present the memento to Sri Rajiv Kapoor, ADGE for All India Radio. Thank you very much, sir. And if I may request the president of BES, Sri CBS Maurya ji, to please come on the stage and present the memento to our session chairperson, Mr. R. Obreja. Thank you very much. A really loud of applause, a round of applause, please. Thank you very much. It is very interesting to see everybody here, and it takes even more, it becomes a moment of, I would say, of delight when we have someone who has his birthday. And I would say, is it Mr. Rajesh Kurian? Is it? Oh, it's Johannes's birthday and yours as well? It's Johannes's birthday. I was told differently. Sorry, I stay corrected. Happy birthday and thank you very much. Well, had it been me, I would have been somewhere else taking a party. But thank you. It's a party here of thoughts. Thank you very much for your invaluable time and happy birthday once again on behalf of everybody. On that note, please don't go anywhere because we've got one of the most interesting and most important award ceremonies. And on that note, please, may I request Sri CBS Maurya, President of BES, Sri Aftab Ahmed, Honorary Secretary, and Sri OP Raj Purohit, Honorary Treasury, to please come on the stage. The reason why I invite them here is because the local chapters of BES India spread across the country have been organizing conferences, seminars, lectures on current and upcoming technology. The president of Broadcast Engineering Society India is pleased to place on record the excellent service recorded to BES India by the local chapters. In this direction, may I please request the recipients of the awards to come as I announce. May I request Sri V.K. Jain, Chapter Chairman from Ahmedabad, Chapter, to please come and receive the award from our dignitaries. On that note, please can I also request the audience members to kindly give a massive round of applause for the tireless work that has been done for the progress of the BES every year. And it wouldn't have been possible without the diligence and the hard work of the local body chapters. May I please request Sri Anil Kumar, Chapter Chairman, Bangalore, to please come and receive this memento of our appreciation on behalf of the BES team. Very, very congratulations, Sri Anil Kumar. On behalf of Mumbai, may I please request the chapter chairman, Sri S.C. Khasgiwal, please may I request you to come and receive your award for recognizing the work that you have done, for your inputs and for your hard work. And let the applause not die, please, if I can request you all, this is definitely a mode of encouragement. Thank you. May I request for the chapter chairperson for Thanjavur, Ms. A. Chitra, to please come and receive a token of our appreciation on behalf of BES. This is a recognition for all of your efforts and inputs that you have tirelessly been doing to bring forth. Can I now request Chairman Local Chapter, Sri A.V. Swaminathan, to please come and accept please may I call Mr. A.V. Swaminathan on behalf of the chapter committee to kindly come and accept his award for the Pune chapter. May I also request Sri Sitaram to please come and collect this token of our appreciation on behalf of Hyderabad chapter. May I also request Sri Natarajan for the Chennai chapter to please come and collect this token of our appreciation on behalf of the BES team. I really appreciate for the ones who are applauding. Thank you very much. A massive round of applause, please. Thank you. With that, we conclude this ceremony and this session. Please join us for the tea, which is being served. And I would be seeing you for the next session, which would be commencing in just a short while. And it is broadcasting and streaming, Blurring the Boundaries. See you in a short while. Please, if I may request Sri Ajay Gupta to kindly lead all the panelists and the speakers here on the dais, please. This session will be chaired by Sri Ajay Gupta, who is presently working as the Engineer-in-Chief at Prasar Bharati, All India Radio and Doordarshan. Mr. Gupta has served at different working and management positions in his 32 years of long career in AIR and Doordarshan. Besides heading and leading project activities, he has spent a considerable part of his career in the management of operation and maintenance of All India Radio and Doordarshan Network. He made his career's beginning with his long stay in All India Radio and Doordarshan Kendras, dealing with large variety of broadcast activities. During his tenure in Doordarshan Directorate, he played a key role in successfully planning, coordinating, and implementing mega TV coverages of various national and international sport events, including the coverage of Commonwealth Games 2006 at Melbourne and in 2010 at Delhi. Mr. Gupta, having natural inclination to core technicalities in various engineering aspects of AIR and DD, Doordarshan, his hobby is also not far different, making him a veteran in the line of HAM radio. He is an amateur HAM with call sign VU2DED. He is active on voice and digital communication modes in HF bands of HAM radio and has won various international awards in different amateur radio competitions world over. Consequent to Nepal earthquake, he was also a member of Disaster Management HAM radio team facilitating voice communication. Mr. Ajay Gupta obtained his degree in electronics engineering with honors and gold medal in 1984. He made use of his strong academics in serving a short stint as teaching faculty in Engineering College. Subsequently, he joined All India Radio and Doordarshan in 1987 through 1984 batch of Indian Engineering Services. Ladies and gentlemen, please put a warm welcome, applause, a warm welcome to welcome our chairperson for the session, Mr. Ajay Gupta. Sir, over to you.
Not in the broadcasting, and with the advantage, the technology, the broadcasting is now no more linear and shifting towards the non-linear modes, the OTT streaming and whatnot. So we have a very eminent and expert panel here who will be deliberating about the various aspect of latest trends regarding streaming and other modes of broadcasting. And when it comes to the streaming and cloud management, the internet is there, and when the internet is there, there is always a fear of security due to cyber attack and all that. So we have a panelist here who will share his experience and will guide how to protect the broadcasting network from the cyber security. So to start with, we have the first panelist, Mr. Charanjeev Singh, who is the head of marketing MediaKind. Mr. Singh, with 32 years of experience in ICT industry, has got the right balance of technology, alliance, and marketing. Mr. Charanjeev, responsible for marketing and communication at MediaKind, spanning a brand experience, solution, and portfolio marketing in internal engagement and events. The marketing and communication team is driving the creation and establishment of MediaKind, MediaKing, as a leading global media technology brand. In his previous role at Ericsson, Mr. Charanjeev was responsible for driving a global pre-sales function at Ericsson for services, OSS, BSS and media businesses. He has led several key functions as a pre-sales service, a technology, alliance, and customer project management. He has held several key positions in Ericsson, NetApp, IBM, Sun Microsystems, Tata Unisys, and HCL. Mr. Charanjeev holds a master's degree in computer application and an MBA in finance. He also holds several industry certifications, including ITSM, and is a regular speaker at industry events. So now the floor is yours, Mr. Charanjeev.
Thank you.
Yeah, good afternoon. Thanks for being here. So in the next 30 minutes, I'll try and cover the global trends in the media processing industry that we are seeing. And I'll try and cover as much as possible in the time frame that I have got. So as we move on, if you look at in 5 year slots, so if you look back 5 years what has happened in the last 5 years, this was a survey which was done by Ericsson Consumer Lab in 2017, so it's still very much valid. If you notice, about more than half, half of the respondents said they are consuming more HD content. There is a lot more binge watching which is happening there. And you know, the viewers are looking at different services. There is more on-demand content they are looking for. And that's actually a reality. If we look back on, you know, how much we were consuming the linear TV versus what we are doing now, personally, that is the reality. And if we look forward 5 years from now, so the TV or the, you know, the video viewing experience will move to the next level. It's already moving that way. We are talking about viewing TV in virtual reality or mixed reality, as it's called. And there is a lot more use of voice control. You know, everyone has either Alexa at home or Google Home or some of those devices through which you are controlling how you are viewing the content and on which devices you want to view it. There is going to be more demand around 360-degree video content, and that is something which I'll cover in the afternoon session. So if I look forward, so what can I get and versus what do I want? So if you see on the left side, you know, you have these linear video channels that are coming on your regular broadcast TV, Star Plus, Color, ZTV, you name it, you have it. But more and more what you're looking at is on-demand content and content to be consumed wherever you are. So that's where, you know, your the OTT apps like Hotstar, Netflix, Hangama, Ditto TV. So that's where, and if you look at, you know, pardon me for saying, but if I look at the room here, most of us are the older generation. The newer generation actually doesn't even want to watch TV on the large screen TV anymore, right? If they want to watch it, they want to watch it on their small screens, on their tabs or on their mobiles, and they want to consume it anywhere. So that is where the convergence between the streaming TV and the pay TV is coming about. So we had done a little bit of study last year ourselves, and I will try and share some insights from there here. So the big thought is, you know, where is the future of TV? Where is it going? So the future of TV, as we look at, is there are three different angles to it. One is streaming. So streaming of the video on multiple devices at the same time is a reality today. And that's where it's going to be more and more focused. ABR technology, the adaptive bitrate technology, it is used to, you know, we are using that to deliver efficient and quality videos even on a on a high latency network. The video viewing or the content consumption is becoming more and more social in nature. Nowadays, you know, you want to share what you are watching, you want to want to be part of the crowd. So if you have watched something and, you know, there are other people you want to discuss it online, you want to invite people into what we call as a social collaborative watching. So you may not be sitting together, but you may be still watching the same program, sharing comments on that, and sharing your perceptions or your preferences for it. And more importantly, how do we make sure that the content that is coming to you is kept secure? Piracy is still a big challenge, especially in a country like India, where you can, you know, so how do, you know, even though you're providing the content, how do you make sure that, you know, it's not getting copied and pirated? So that's the other third aspect about the future of TV. So these are the three main angles when we look at the future of TV. And as we move forward, industry is shifting. You know, pay TV is now being used more as a streaming TV, and streaming TV is being used as a pay TV. So that's sort of, you know, the boundaries between the two are blurring. The other aspect is, you know, the content owners who own the content, they want to go directly to the consumer. And streaming TV is a mechanism through which they are going directly to the consumer also. So if you notice, like BBC and all these, rather than giving it only to the broadcaster, they are actually taking the content directly to the end consumer as well. And there are more, the other aspect is, how do you monetize, how do you make money out of it? So that is about the ad revenues and the subscription-based services. So obviously, if I don't want to pay, I will have to, as a consumer, I have to be willing to watch some ads in between the program that I'm watching. But if I want an ad-free experience, then I can pay for it. So I have a choice there. But yes, both offerings are available. And there is an accelerating shift to the OTT, because you want to watch your content on the go. So you can't be linked to, or you can't be fixed to a location. You can't be, while you are at home, you may be watching it on your broadband or on your satellite TV. But when you are on the go, you want to watch it the same program or continue watching it while you are traveling in a metro or in a bus, or when you are sitting in your office and you want to watch something. So that is where the result is, the convergence of over the air and the pay TV platform, they are merging. And more importantly, what we are seeing, at least in the mature markets, you know, a lot of operators or service providers are actually combining the video services as an offering, as a skinny bundle that is available. So they are also looking at how do they make more money without just being the pipe provider, but more importantly, how do they make more money out of the content that they can carry on their network. So if you look at the streaming pay TV, there is a global shift that is happening. So with it becoming more popular than the traditional pay TV, the survey suggests that through 2023, there'll be more there'll be more of streaming TV services which will be available. And there are some numbers, I'm not going to cover all of them, but if you look at, it talks about the number of global direct-to-consumer subscribers may reach a whopping 25 million in the US alone. And if you look at the number of the global streaming TV, subscriber, they may reach 77 million in total, out of which some 25, 28 million will be in North America, but there is going to be a 16 million in India. So there is a big opportunity in India if we are able to monetize and be on the bandwagon. More importantly, it's not only about just the the service, it also how do you manage that operation. So what as a service provider, what you're looking at is how do I get my content or my offering faster to the market? So how do I launch more services quickly? How do I remove the media flow silos? How do I make my infrastructure in a way that I can quickly launch a new service without having to rejig all my infrastructure? So, and also how do I enable new revenue streams? The one option what we are seeing is cloud is becoming a reality in media technology also. So it's no more the silos. While the specialized customized hardware application were good, they were able to give us the type of quality of experience that we need, but then it was very, very siloed. So you could not launch a new service because that would take you a long time to set up the infrastructure, get the service up and running. With cloud, that is a thing of the past. With the cloud, it becomes infrastructure agnostic, and more importantly, how it helps us avoid the technology lock-in. And program, maybe you would like to look at these two, these additional programs. So, and that is something which is the reality, because analytics platforms and the recommendation engine services, they can give you that type of experience. So it's all about moving from appliances to apps. So gone are the days, I won't say that they are completely gone, we still have silos available, but any new implementation we are looking at is going more towards cloud and vendor agnostic services. So the appliances, it becomes all about applications. And more importantly, so just to quickly cover on cloud, obviously, I don't think cloud is something which you are hearing for the first time. So just to give you a perspective of, if you look from left to the right, so left is your standard legacy, implementations where it's an appliance base. There is a customized appliance hardware with a customized application which is running on top of it. So it's very fixed, it's very siloed. It's very difficult to scale, because if you had to add more scale to that, you have to, maybe tear it down and bring up a new instance completely with the new hardware and all. So it's very difficult. Then the next level or next evolution is the virtualization, where you are going to have an orchestration layer in between the hypervisor, but you are still running apps on top of it. So it obviously, makes it easy to replicate. You are able to use your hardware infrastructure in a much better way. You can run multiple VMs on a single hardware platform, but it is still in terms of challenge to scale that type of infrastructure. There is always a loss of performance, because any orchestration layer will have its own delays and its own asks on the hardware. So it creates delays in the processing as well. And the next level where we are now heading is the microservices and the orchestrated container infrastructure, where it's completely built to scale, it's flexible, and it's a infrastructure agnostic. Virtualization can be there, or it's an optional, because you are looking at a container which is a complete user application which can run any of the platforms. But there is always a downside to it. It is new, so obviously people have to get used to it. You have to rewrite your applications. You have to rewrite your content based on that, and it is complex, at least for now. As it, you see more and more adoption of it in the industry. Obviously, we will have more skill set available to deploy and manage it also. So that is where we are going. And it opens a new era of applications. So obviously, in terms of operations, it will help us boost the operations, improve efficiencies, agile development and operations, and faster rollouts, which addresses my time to market challenges. As a service, one of the thing is, supposing you are, even let's look at IPL, which is a typical match which lasts 3 hours, right? To build the entire infrastructure just for 3 hours and take it down is a big ask. But if you are having it as a service, you can quickly bring up the instance for those 3 hours, do your media processing on that instance and tear it down. And if you are using containers, you can also, as let's say if a particular match becomes interesting and all of a sudden you see a lot of subscribers getting onto it, you can actually scale it elastically. So all that is available as a service. And then, of course, it helps us in new applications like cloud disaster recovery. While you have your primary instance, you may have another instance which is just your DR site, which is actually just lying idle. So why do you want to invest twice in infrastructure? So might as well put your disaster recovery site onto the cloud and use it as needed. And things like dynamic ad insertion. So these are some of the things I'll cover. In terms of the operator's typical journey to the cloud, so most of us started somewhere here, where it was, as I said, very customized hardware and application stack. Moving more towards a software monolithic type of architecture, which could run on a data center with virtualization, and some of it could be running on a private cloud. But as we move forward, as we move up the value chain, the application control goes from a per application basis to a central control, converged monitoring, and then scripted flexible operations. So I can actually run it either on a private cloud or on a public cloud, and I can move my applications easily enough. And then ultimate goal is I will manage it as a service. So you're not managing an application, you're managing an experience for a service for the consumer. So that's where the journey of the cloud, and that is sort of the utopia for an operator. Once you get there, then you can launch your services quickly and without any worry about how am I going to scale my infrastructure to support it, how am I going to manage it, because everything is controlled as a service through a central operations. So I'll just sort of build this up and quickly cover some part of it, but again, it's a very busy slide, so I don't want to spend too much time on it. But if you look at, there were two streams which are there, the broadcast managed delivery and the unmanaged, which was running, typically your OTT delivery, which is going on your unmanaged network. But when we move from that to the cloud-based services, even your broadcast or your managed services can be residing in the cloud, as well as your OTT applications. So it becomes more single consolidated stack that you're managing. So as MediaKind, we have we have been investing in the cloud. We have, all our applications are now cloud native. So we are looking at cloud native architecture. We are using Kubernetes and we are using containers. And what that gives you is complete flexibility where, you can launch a service, you can do analytics and monitoring, you can do the complete application stack management through the architecture that we have. And you can run it on any, be it on a bare metal, be it on an OpenStack, or it could be running on Google or Amazon or Microsoft Azure. So that all is available even today now. Let's switch gears a bit. Look at some of the C&D market trends. So traditionally, in the contribution and primary distribution area, satellite was the king, and it was expensive, right? And that is because you wanted, the quality and reliability that the satellite provides, but the challenge is it is very expensive. So with the introduction of faster networks, for example, 4G, and now we are talking about 5G in India, it gives you a lot more flexibility. It gives you the similar throughput and the security that you know, a satellite network will provide, but it gives you a lot of flexibility at a much lower cost. Also, as if you notice, you know, we have fiber available to some of the larger venues where typically your regular events happen. So that gets captured. So you don't necessarily have to put a studio or a production environment in the venue itself. You can do remote production thanks to the bandwidth that's available, thanks to the technology that is available today. And the production tools and playout is already moving to the cloud. So you can actually spin up an instance for that particular event and package your content and deliver it. And on the primary distribution side, again, everything is moving to IP, right? IP was very prevalent in an IT environment, but in a media or a video environment, you can't afford to lose even a frame because you can't retransmit a frame. So that's why things like secure, reliable transport, SRT, and with the movement has enabled us to move to IP. So with the cloud and IP, transformation to IP, it gives you a lot more flexibility. It gives you flexibility to even leverage unmanaged network like internet. So if I look at the contribution trends, we will look at it in three horizons. So the horizon one is basically, and that is a reality even now. So if you notice, some of the news channels are actually recording, the breaking news on their mobile cameras. And they are just uploading it to the studio. And that is a reality. Even with the 3G and 4G, they are able to do. And once 5G is available in the country, it will become even better. As I talked about the fiber availability at the events, so that gives you a lot of flexibility. And using IP over that secure and reliable transport. UHD HDR is something which is a reality now. So no more we are talking about just HD. World is actually talking about 8K, but I would say 8K is still something in the future, but 4K is a reality. And like Olympics, which in Tokyo Olympics, which are happening this year, they are going to actually also transmit in 8K there. But in India, we are still working on 4K, of course, because that's basically because of the devices, and the people still don't have the devices available and all. But yeah, that's where, from a global perspective, this is where the market is moving. And as I talked about the pay-as-you-go events coverage. Second horizon is, how do I make it into a differential experience for some of my consumers? Things like immersive experience. If I want to give them a premium service besides just the regular service they are getting on their linear TV, can I give them, an experience of being there in that venue? So that is where the differentials are, and I can always charge for that, right? I can always charge for that premium service. Supposing for IPL matches, we say, okay, I'll give you a 360-degree view of the match, and I'll charge you maybe 300 rupees for the whole season. I'm sure a lot of us will actually want to do that. So there are, these are the possibilities which are there even now. Esports is actually a big thing, not so much in India, but globally it is a big phenomenon. And in the recently concluded IBC at in Netherlands in September, they actually, on the last day, they had an esports event there. And from MediaKind, we had actually covered that into 360-degree. We gave 360-degree coverage of that particular event. And that is something which creates a type of differentiation between you and your competition. And more importantly, AI. Everyone talks about AI and machine machine learning. How do you leverage that in media technologies? I have a slide there. I'm not sure I'll have time enough to cover it, but let's move forward. On the primary distribution side, again, adapting the latest video codec technologies, moving from MPEG-2 or MPEG-4 AVC to HEVC will reduce the distribution bandwidth requirements. We are already looking at moving from satellite to fiber, which is definitely cheaper than the satellite bandwidth. And UHD HDR content. So I talked about events like Olympics and all, which will be actually transmitting, covering everything in UHD. Obviously, you can bring it down to HD or SD levels also, but they will actually create everything in 8K and 4K. Centralized distribution. So with this, it's the second horizon as we look at, how do I reduce the cost by centralizing all my operation in terms of distribution processing? So that is something where, and it gives me a lot of other benefits. If I centralize that, I can actually manage my ad processing, my regionalization, and my ad insertion. So I can actually give you targeted ads based on each of the consumer or each of the location. I can give you, the primary distribution is also we are looking at moving into the cloud. And more importantly, how do I give an end-to-end solution for the content owner? So as a content owner, I should be able to reach to the end consumer myself. And that's something which a lot of content owners are looking for. So that is the third horizon where, the content owner can ensure the delivery to the end consumer themselves. Looking again at some of the direct-to-consumer market trends. So as I talked about Olympics, it will be the biggest streaming event with which is going to be there in the world, and that happens this year. Broadcasters are looking at how to more efficiently use the spectrum, how to drive more and more UHD and HDR content, and again, we talked about advertising already. Looking at the operational excellence, like ATSC 3.0, which got launched in US, gives us a lot of operational benefits as well. Renewal of the headend based on the hardware obsolescence and moving to a hybrid headend rather than a dedicated headend. So I can always have a headend which is sitting in the cloud and I can actually still get the same service that I was getting from a dedicated headend. It's also not only about the video, it's also about the immersive audio. How do I give, there are new two codecs that we are looking at, which is MPEG-H from Fraunhofer, and then AC4 from Dolby. This actually gives you, features like dynamic objects. It gives you optimal rendering for any loudspeaker configuration. It also allows a consumer to personalize his listening experience, his or her listening experience. And of course, the inherent benefit is also the bitrate saving due to the new tools they have developed and employed. You get efficiency even in that sense. Looking at the video side, now constant video quality is something. So typically, the moving from a CBR, which is a constant bitrate, to a constant video quality, it gives us a significant benefit. Typically, if you notice at any video stream that is coming, a frame, there are certain parts of the video which are static. There are other parts which are very dynamic, which are changing. So rather than transmitting the entire frame, I can only transmit the bits that are there, which are dynamic or which are changing, while I don't transmit the bits that are there in, which are fixed or which are not changing in the video that I'm streaming in that particular set of frames. That way, I can do a lot of saving on the bandwidth. It also gives me the same bitrate and increases the quality. And it helps me reduce the storage space that I need on my side also to store that content. The technical documentation of this particular solution is available with us. So if you are interested, we will be able to provide that. And again, just a quick one on the machine learning for the video processing. If you notice the two, I don't know how on this screen how it good or bad it looks, but if you notice that the area around the eye of the parrot on the left side bottom frame, you will see it's hazy. With the AI and the deep learning and the neural network that we deploy, we are able to teach or train our algorithm to look for these distortions and fix it. So if you notice the right side, it is much more defined. The lines around the eyes are a bit more defined. I'm not sure if you are able to sort of get the real thing out of this screen, but that's, and that, the important thing is the algorithm actually is self-learning. So it will actually understand how these images are getting fixed, and they will actually, any new images that come in or any new video that comes in, it will automatically be able to correct that also. So that's something which is currently in operation with us, and obviously we continue to invest more in this particular technology. Moving on to the low latency adaptive bitrate. The current adaptive bitrate is typically giving you a latency of 30 to 60 seconds, which is good in the sense that if you're watching a program on a slow network, you are still able to get a good quality experience, viewing experience. But then it's not really useful for live, right? Because if you're watching a live sporting event or any live event, let's say, it's a cricket match and, on your big TV, you're seeing that, he's already hit the batsman has got bowled and he's out. On your OTT, you're still seeing he's still playing on 99, right? So that is not really useful for live events. So there is a lot of focus in the industry on how do we reduce this latency between the OTT and the linear TV. So currently with the end-to-end reduced latency ABR, where we are, instead of sending a big chunk of video, we are sending it in smaller segments, smaller buffers, and we are able to balance the latency with the network variability. We are able to bring it down somewhere around 6 to 7 seconds, which is still okay, because at least if you're watching it on a mobile device and your neighbor starts shouting, at least by the time they start seeing the replay, you will also see it. So it's still not near live, it's not fully broadcast quality, but it's near broadcast. And with 5G networks which are coming, you are able to drive with the network slicing, you will be able to drive individual multicast streams to individual subscribers. That will actually even reduce the latency to sub 2 seconds. So that's where we are going with the advancement on the network side and also advancement in the technology. So obviously with 5G, it gives you a lot more options. Again, this is something future looking. Obviously, when I'm looking at it, it's already being rolled out in mature markets. India is still considering 5G rollouts, is still not happening. But in US and all, what we are seeing is the operators are actually coming out with these skinny bundles. So they are offering these, 30, like for example, get 30 plus live TV channels. It's super skinny bundle, but you can expand it if you want more. It plays on your TV, you can play it on your TV, and you can also play it on your, any device. And it, by the way, you can bundle it, so it comes free with unlimited data subscription, for example. So these are some of the things which T-Mobile is offering in the US, for example. I still have time. Right. So another aspect is, how do I optimize the complete audio-visual solution to deliver the personalized TV experience? Again, that is something, that's a solution which is available from our side. It gives you the broadcast quality across all devices. So be it on your mobile or on your large screen TV, we have a facility to drive per user targeted advertising and content replacement based on the user's past viewing behavior. It gives you benefits of bandwidth and storage optimization, and quality of experience and playback analytics and automatic adjustments are possible. So you can also monitor how your service is running and optimize it based on those analytics that you're getting. So as we look at, this is my last slide. So the business models are evolving, right? So there is an offer which is available for any type of requirements. You could go with a purpose-built, saying that, no, I want a very purpose-built customized hardware and software stack that only works for me. That's fine. You have the cloud native available, which basically you still own that application, but it is running either on a hybrid cloud, which could be a mixture of your own data center or your private cloud, or a amalgamation of private and public cloud. You can license it across different platforms flexibly. You are paid, you're paying per channel or per user basis, but then as a service. So as a service, what you're looking at is you pay for what you use. So it's more software deployed in the cloud, and you basically subscribe to that particular offering for the period of time that you need. You bring up that instance, you get you pay only for the time that you use, and it gets torn down automatically, and it can expand or contract elastically. So that was a very quick insight into the various market trends. Thank you for your time. And do I have any time for questions, or we take it later?
I think we will continue with the discussions, and we will take the questions later. Thank you very much, Mr. Singh.
Thank you.
Very informative and precise regarding the blurring and converging of the technologies in the broadcast, especially thoughtful, the app-based devices, which are very flexible to have future compliance of broadcasting technologies rather than the hardware-based. So now we have the content which is in place and which is on the channels also. So now definitely we need the devices to show that contents to the final consumer. So we have Mr. Virendra Sharma from Samsung. Let me read out his resume. Mr. Sharma is presently working in the R&D division of Samsung from the past 17 years, and he is a specialist in visual display products. He is handling digital television strategy in the APAC and MENA region. He is also responsible for India TV DA product innovations. His role includes DTV, pay TV operations strategy for entire region. His overall experience include embedded systems, telecom domain, visual display products. So please welcome Mr. Virendra Sharma.
So good afternoon, everyone. I would like to start with the famous saying that nothing is constant in this world except change. So I believe that change is inevitable in the broadcast industry. And if it is inevitable in the broadcast industry, it is inevitable on the receiver side as well. So there is a lot of discussion going on the disruptive technologies like 5G, AI, OTT, etc. But actually, it is affecting the receiver industry as well. So receivers are becoming more and more complex due to these technologies, as these need to be integrated on the receiver side as well. Another thing is that consumer behavior is changing. Consumer is more demanding. So they are not happy with only with the TV as an entertainment device, but they also want to include it as a part of their lifestyle. So today, I will talk about the Samsung innovation to support disruptive technology or the broadcast. So major five areas we have seen shift in the receiver industries, that analog TVs have become digital, then we have seen smart TVs, and now we can call them millennial TVs or lifestyle TVs. Another thing is that linear services have become hybrid, linear and OTT, and screen resolution from SD, HD, 4K, now we are talking about 8K. So 4K receivers are at cheaper price today and affordable for the consumer. Then consumer also want larger screens at home. So there is a shift from small to large screens. And the way the consumer accesses the device, like from the remote UI, through UI, etc., now it is changing. The voice is another way of accessing the TV. So first, I would like to introduce you Sero TV. So this TV is basically for the mobile generation. You already heard about that. Okay, mobile is the major thing which is used by the people. And the way they are using the people, the TV has to change based upon the behavior of the mobile usage. So whenever you use the mobile, you use it either vertically or for some case like playing games or maybe watching the videos, it has to be horizontal. But have you noticed your TV is always mounted in the wall as a horizontal state, or it is kept as a horizontal state? And if you mirror your content from your mobile to the TV, then at the center you will see the content, and the left-hand side of the screen, it is always black. And that experience to the consumer is not good. So it has to be at par with the mobile. So that's why this Sero TV has been created. It is for the mobile generation people. So we have a SmartThings app on the mobile, which connect TV and mobile, and they has to be on the same network. So what happens is that this TV is equipped with NFC technology as well. So I just touch with my mobile with the TV, and it starts mirroring the content on the TV side. And to get the same experience, I can configure it that my mobile, if I make it portrait to landscape, my TV also rotates. It has a motor, and it just rotates to that vertical mode. And then I can have the same experience as my mobile. And I can also have that my mobile is vertical and TV remains horizontal, and I can do it through my remote. So that is also possible. So all the combinations are possible. So apart from this, if you want to have only audio, so you can just connect it through the Bluetooth, and there is a beautiful animation on the TV side, which gives you the vibrant environment. And then your music you can access directly on the 60-watt speakers, which are not on the TV, but the stand which it has. It has a stand where there are 60-watt speakers. So you can use those speakers for your music. So now I will talk about lifestyle TVs, the frame and serif TV. So basically, the consumer demands that when TV is not used as an entertainment device, so how can I get extra out of it? So we all must have paintings at our home. So what if my TV is at the wall and it behaves like a painting and it looks like a painting? So that's the another use case. So Samsung has introduced frame TV for that purpose. So you can put it into the frame mode. You can access Samsung has already partnered with the galleries in the world, and you can access 1,000 plus art from there. Apart from that, the people want to create memories at their home. They have their own paintings, their own hobbies, and they also have their own images and family bonding kind of pictures, which they would like to display. So they can use this TV for that purpose. So apart from your normal TV, it can also give you experience about your lifestyle. Then another is serif TV. If you have a furniture and your TV is on the wall and it is a black in a color, you would not like. And you, if you're placing it on the table, you would like to match its decor with the table. So this frame TV, basically it has luminous sensor. So what happens is that when you display the picture on the screen, so that has to be adjusted based upon the brightness in the room. So based upon this sensor, that picture is automatically adjusted. And then user also want to set the frame of that particular picture. So that is also possible in this case. And the way you can access it, it could be through Bixby, Samsung AI-powered solution, voice. And similarly, serif TV. Have you ever heard that any TV is designed by the furniture expert? So this TV basically was designed by Paris-based design brothers Ronan and Arvan, the world's most famous industrial designers that specialize in furniture. So serif TV has also won the awards, design awards. So this TV basically gel well with your furniture, and then you have an ambient mode. So in ambient mode, if you would like to display the background part in the TV, so that it gels completely with your surroundings, so that is possible with this. So it becomes as a part of your furniture. So initially, you would be surprised to know that this TV was sold in the furniture shops as well. Now I would like to talk about QLED 8K TVs. So basically, consumer demands from smaller to larger screens. Consumer also demands from lower resolution to higher resolution. Even if there is no content in the market, in global markets we have seen due to social case or whatever it is, but demand is there, and people want to have bigger resolution and larger screen. So this QLED 8K TV also includes quantum AI processor, and it uses AI ScaleNet technology, which I'll introduce in the next slide. And the interesting feature of this is object tracking sound. Like usually when you want to have 5.1 channel surround sound, so what you do is you connect your home theater system. But what if you don't require that extra piece of hardware and your TV behaves like that and you give experience in the TV itself? So you do have 6 speakers in this TV with 2 subwoofers. And then when your subject is moving on the screen, so the technology is that you can access the individual speaker and that particular part of the screen, the particular speaker can be used. And apart from that, the customer can choose 14 layouts in which he wants to access or he wants to watch this his movie. For example, like side by side or picture in picture, etc. Then what is AI ScaleNet? So I can call it like AI streaming codec as well, because the content reaching the content to the TV receiver is difficult. So what you can do is like 8K content, how we can deliver. Currently, Samsung has a technology wherein, for example, we have a 4K TV. So if the my content is like FHD, it can convert to 4K TV receiver side itself to give that near experience. So that is already possible, but this is a new technology for the 8K. So 8K content will be compressed at the delivery side, and then it will travel at the 4K capable networks. And when it reaches to the receiver side, it will be again made as a 8K, and then it will be. So for the delivery part, this technology is there, AI ScaleNet. So we are using deep learning for this. I would like to introduce a TVKey cloud technology as well for pay TV markets, and I call it as an interoperable TV. So why do I call it as an interoperable TV is that consumer has a choice. He can change the operator. He can change the operator from his house at instant. So he has a choice that he want subscription of any particular operator, so he can do with this. And then operator also has a choice to provide the offerings to the customer, to provide the customization of the UI UX to the consumer, and the services they want to provide like VOD or catch up. Even the TV is launched. So you can imagine like someone has bought a new TV. He has plugged that device directly into the satellite or cable or terrestrial or IP mediums. And then he gets some kind of operator listings that he want to choose, and then he choose the operator. Then he gets the offerings from the operators, 3 months free, 6 months free, etc. And when he pays that subscription, he will instantly activate it and get the services on the TV. So this technology has hardware security as well, because the content providers, they do have a concern that platform should be very secure. So there is a hardware root of trust in this technology, which makes it very secure. And the content owners can have confidence that, okay, if this technology is there, they can provide the 4K content to the operators. And operators also has advantage because they don't need to invest on the set-top boxes. Their main business is of service side. So they can provide, they can invest more on the content part, not on the set-top box side. So how does it work is that, as I said, like it can work on terrestrial cable, satellite, IP, all. And there is a two-way connectivity. So your security goes on the cloud side. So security is built on the cloud side. So it's a hybrid model. So you can have linear services from the terrestrial, satellite, or cable. And the VOD, catch-up, all those kind of experiences could be built through the IP. It depends upon the operator, what he wants to give. But minimum part is the security part. So if your CAS is on the cloud, so there would be a CAS interoperability on the TV side. So there is no need of changing anything. So that particular CAS which is used by the operator can be used with this technology, which is called out-of-band ECM feature. So if you look at this, imagine that a consumer has powered up a TV. So Samsung TV has Smart Hub. So when it is initializing, what will happen is that operator make a small app, which is called an installer app, that goes to the Samsung TVKey server. So TV is connected to the TVKey server. It checks how many operators installer app is there. So it will automatically fetch that and put it inside the settings of a TV. So consumer will, at runtime, he can check that, okay, now there are two operators, now there are three operators, and he has a choice for the operator. So he can just choose the operator. So once he chooses the operator, what happens, TV connects to the operator server. So what kind of experience they have built, like VOD, catch-up, or whatever, based upon the HBB TV application. And the advantage is that if there is HBB TV application, it is not platform dependent. It can work on any platform. So that experience, what is built by the operator, that can be upgraded, and that comes to the TV side and downloaded in the TV. Now TV is no more like a Samsung TV experience. Its EPG, its channel list, everything would be changed as per operator. Even the remote control functions can also be reprogrammed by the operator from his side. So that is the beauty of this technology. So now I would talk about the India localization, because I think like same yardstick cannot work in global and the local markets. And India is very, very special country, and no other country I would say is like India. So here in India, like music is very important. So if you see the generation from 60s to 90s music, if you see, which is very, very popular, and today also people listen to that music. So what if your TV behaves like a music system? And what if the skin of the music system is like retro theme? So people will love it. And then this TV is connected online through some content provider who is providing online music. But the newer generation may not like the retro theme. So we have a modern theme for them. And they can listen the new song with this. And then we have a couple of other features as well, like home cloud on the TV side. You have a USB stick, and then when you step in to your home, you can transfer to your contacts to USB. And apart from that, TV can share some audio songs, and mobile can also share audio songs to your TV, etc. And universal guide is which will give you hybrid experience like OTT and linear channel on the guide. So you can access your OTT and linear channel from a particular page directly. And we have smart browser. And then India is a special country where a lot of languages are there. So Indian English accent or maybe the languages are very important. So that part is also there. And a lot of apps are already there on the smart TV side. Now I will talk about the luxury section. So what happens that when we go for a movie, we go with a family to our cinema hall. But what if the cinema hall comes to your room? So that is the kind of case here I would like to present. So this is a 146-inch micro LED display, which can go up to 292-inch as well. We have three variants in this. So you can think a case where service provider or the content providers is providing experience like maybe first day, first show kind of content or at your home, and you have this display at your home. So it will be like cinema at the home, and you can watch the content with your family, and it will be a very, very good experience. So this wall is already launched in India. Now I would like to talk about the digital butler also, which is Bolly from Samsung. So it was shown in CES 2020 this year. So it's a human-centric vision of robot that takes care, personalized care to the next level. So in this case, like how it can interact with our TV, how it can interact with our, it can take care of your family as well. It can also take care of your pets. It can change your lifestyle fully. So with the last slide and 2 minutes video, I would like to leave with you an open thought that tomorrow could our smart homes look like this, and there could be a personal assistant like Bolly. And could there be a TV as a central device, which will be a central device which takes care of my health, fitness, giving me all the information on my TV, and smart assisting us to control the TV. So let's enjoy this 2 minutes video.
Bali.
Thank you so much. That's all I have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sharma. Very informative and lively presentation. So friends, now we have the content distribution and the devices to watch all what we have. Now we are really worried about the security of the content and the worries of the consumer or the viewer regarding disrupting of its viewing. So this security concern is very important for the broadcaster and also for the viewers. So to stop piracy and disruption of the services. So we have a very famous face in the broadcasting, Mr. Nadeem from ABU. And he does not need introduction, but just to. So he's the ABU director. So Mr. Nadeem, please. And please welcome him.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, Namaskar, Assalamu Alaikum. It's good to be on the stage again, a second time. Yeah, we're going to move slightly away from the streaming side of video and talk about a little bit about cybersecurity, because we are all moving towards streaming, towards connected networks, towards providing connectivity to everyone, as well as our organization, broadcast systems, which actually opens up a gateway to hackers. Just to start with a few pointers that I took from research published by Cybint, where it says a hacker attack is reported every 39 seconds. It's not only for media, this is overall. So unfilled cybersecurity jobs worldwide will reach 3.5 million by 2021. I think it's a good time to think about a new career now. More than 77% of organizations do not have a cybersecurity incident response plan. So this is very alarming for us. And most companies take nearly 6 months to detect a data breach, even major ones. And finally, 95% of cybersecurity breaches are due to human error. Right? So once you go through these slides, I have rather than explaining why we are talking about cybersecurity, especially from a broadcast point of view, I thought I'll just run a quick video clip to show what happened to Fox News in 2015.
As you had said, when you released from jail and you was beginning after parole, I'm out of that business. But are you? A lot of folks say that if someone came in and they needed your help and wanted to die, the Jack Kevorkian would help them. Would you?
I would help if they deserve it.
Dear Fox News, it has come to our attention that you have been alienating the American people by propagating the left-right false dichotomy, promoting fear by exaggerating the threat you cannot hide from us. We are anonymous. We are legion. We do not forgive. We do not forget. Expect us.
This actually ran for almost 2 minutes. I've actually shortened the clip. And then, of course, the broadcast continued after that. So why are we talking about cybersecurity? The reason is that we are all moving towards all IP infrastructures, talking about the benefits of clouds, online operations, easy collaboration with developing content, online streaming, and connected systems is the way to go for us. But these technologies also create an environment where connected devices create issues, and if not taken care of, creates vulnerabilities for hackers. I have another video clip to show a simple thing a hacker did to a Netherlands news network. You can keep the volume down because it's subtitled. Anyway, he's talking in Dutch. So what he's doing is he has hacked into the auto queue system of the news presenter. So what he's saying that he's going to play around with it. So first thing he does is he actually increases the speed of the auto queue system. You can see the presenter there, and he's watching the news while he's doing that. So she's asking to slow down. Then he replaces his own text on the auto queue. Anyway, we'll skip forward in the interest of lunch, of course. So, what are the effects of such hacks? So, they could steal valuable content. This has happened before, for example, in the case of HBO. Damages reputation. Data leaks, of course, data breaches are very common, not in the mainly in the broadcast arena or media world, but everywhere else. Software and file corruption and encryption. For example, TE5 Monday, I think last year also when I presented this topic, I did mention about TE5 Monday. This year, I found an interview from a French television that did just after the TE5 Monday, which actually explained, we actually showed how a hack can be done. But I've shortened that clip. Let me just put that clip also online to see how that was done. Okay.
Channels, as well as its website, Facebook, and Twitter accounts. The question on everyone's mind after Francophone news and entertainment station TV5 Monde fell prey to cyber attackers claiming allegiance to ISIS. Well, for the answer, three heads are better than one. We're joined by David Nakache, cryptologist who teaches at France's prestigious École Normale Supérieure. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
You've brought along two graduate students. Maybe you can introduce them to us.
Huda Ferradi, who is one of my PhD students, and Rémi Géraud, who is also a PhD student, both working on security, malware, cryptography, and this kind of things.
So how do you hack 11 TV channels, a website, and the Facebook and Twitter account?
Okay, we looked into this attack to understand what we can gather as information about what happened. Apparently what happened here is that some malicious software was entered into the TV channel. The way in which it entered is not clear yet. Probably it is someone who clicked on a script which he shouldn't have done, receiving a fake email, or it was introduced by an insider. We still don't know. But once this software was executed on the PC, it infected other PCs.
So the hacker didn't have to physically be in the building?
No. He didn't have to be physically in the building. He either sent an email that was executed by someone who was tricked into validating it, or it was introduced by some other way.
So from what you've seen, how does it work exactly?
Okay, you get an email. This email has an attachment. You are invited to open the attachment or to click on the attachment. Once you do that, you launch a malicious software. This malicious software takes control of your computer, and from there hops again and again and again and infects the entire information system.
Right, but how does it hop from the TV station itself, the website, and again, the social networking sites?
Okay, it is sufficient that someone within the TV channel consults his social network from a computer which is installed at work, and then what the malware can do is just spoof the communication, steal the passwords, and provides them to an attacker who is outside.
Is this sophisticated stuff, or is this easy to do?
It depends. We can say that this is an average grade attack.
An average grade attack?
An average grade attack, yeah.
So what does that say about our cyber defenses, if you will?
Okay.
Give it to us straight here.
Okay, systems change very, very quickly, and as they change, we have more and more threats coming in, and these threats allow to do quite extraordinary things nowadays.
This is a bit longer clip, so I've shortened it again. It's available on YouTube if you would like to just go and do a search on TV5 Monday cyber attack. You will be able to see. What follows after this is that the two students actually show how it is done on the screen. For example, how you can hack. But the important thing here is that we can have a security system in place. But what it shows is that it is only as strong as our weakest link, which is a username and a password of any colleague in the organization. So the moment that is open, they can do a lot of things with it. So what are the type of cyber threats that we have? For example, in the last video, he was talking about a malicious software which could just use some SQL injection to your systems, bring it down. Or else, of course, then you have DNS attacks, content piracy, content is stolen from you, or DDoS attacks. In the case of TV5 Monday, it brought down their 11 channels, their website, their Twitter and Facebook handles. Completely down. It was different from the first video which I showed you. It did not show anything on the screen. It just made it go off. It was a blackout, and the blackout lasted for 18 hours. So as broadcasters, you can imagine a blackout going for 18 hours, how much money it is, how much credibility you lose, and so many things. So this is the kind of things that is happening in the world now. It's not very common probably in our region. I don't know if in India this kind of things has happened or not. But this has happened to some of our members. For example, TRT Turkey had an attack. KBS had an attack. KBS Newsroom was hacked, but nothing went on air. But their systems were down for a couple of hours. So things like that. Of course, when systems down, you are not able to run your channel on time. News gets delayed and so many things. So what are we doing about this? We are working very closely with our sister unions, the WBU as well. We have our study projects on available now. Of course, EBU NEBA is doing much stronger than us in this area, and we are learning a lot from them. We are sharing this information with our members. We are coming up with recommendations, guidelines, best practice methods. So far through the WBUTC, we have come up with two recommendations. We are currently working on the third recommendation. The first one was WBU's security recommendations for media vendors, software systems, and services. This document has three parts. It's a quite long document. It actually provides information to broadcasters. If you want to go and buy equipment that are IP-enabled, for example, that connects to IP systems or internet, what kind of security protocols they should follow. So for example, these documents you can use and you can improve your tender documents when it comes to that. The WBU recommendations for cyber security controls, core cyber security controls, these are some guidelines. 6 points actually, I'm going to go through those 6 points again. I think I did last year also, but these are very simple things that can secure your network to over about 70-80% without spending any money. Without investing anything, just few protocols that you can follow to increase your strengths against cyber attacks. The one that we are working right now is the cybersecurity recommendation for cloud services, which is something very becoming very common now. Even broadcasters through their for easy collaboration, we are starting to use cloud systems. Sometimes at work, sometimes for our media applications. We are currently working with it. Hopefully, this documentation, this recommendation set will be available by June this year. The one that I mentioned about core cybersecurity controls, the 6 points, I'll just briefly go through them. I don't want to take a lot of your time because we did this last year also. So, 6 points: actively inventory and track all devices on your network. Prohibit the installation of all software unless it follows a specific approval process. Because you don't want this kind of shareware and things to be installed, especially on computer systems that are connected to your network. Yeah. Establish secure configurations for hardware and software. Continuously run vulnerability assessments and remediation. Minimize administrative privileges only to those who need administrative privileges. Okay. And then institute regular ongoing cybersecurity training for all employees. So these are 6 points that came out in the second recommendation. Again, as I said, there's nothing involved in it. It's just good practice, best practice methods from the industry. All of these recommendations are available for download from our website as well as the World Broadcasting Union's website. So let's talk about technologies that are available for cybersecurity. I think AI is something that we are all talking about. As I mentioned previously, our network is only as strong as our weakest link, which is just a username and password that we give to our staff. So how do we then combat those? This is where AI comes in. So what is happening now is there are two methods that AI works within the system, so it's signature-based method and analytic-based method, where even if you're using your username and password and you log on to your system, it will detect whether it's a regular thing. For example, somebody logs on at 2 a.m. in the morning with your username and password. And if it is not regular, I mean, you only work at daytime. You normally don't work at nighttime. But if your user credentials are used after midnight, for example, then the AI system will be activated. Or somebody uses your username and password and does something that is not regularly done by you. Now, usually, maybe you are given access to some part of your network. But if that username and password is used and you are trying to access something else, again, AI will trigger these kind of actions. So talking about AI, I have two more clips to show you, but this is very interesting. So we are talking about AI technologies being used for these kind of interesting things to protect ourselves. Now we'll take a look at this.
We're entering an era in which our enemies can make it look like anyone is saying anything at any point in time, even if they would never say those things. So, for instance, they could have me say things like, I don't know, Killmonger was right, or Ben Carson is in the sunken place, or how about this, simply, President Trump is a total and complete dipshit. Now, you see, I would never say these things, at least not in a public address, but someone else would, someone like Jordan Peele. This is a dangerous time.